aangifte doen makkelijker maken voor iedereen. Door slimme portals te bouwen voor ondernemers. Dat doen wij. Kijk wat jij kan doen als ICT'er op werken.belastingdienst.nl.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Lisa Norlander and I'm a Java developer at the Dutch Tax Office.
My name is Raman Angstsmit. I'm a design authority at the Center of Excellence Group at the Dutch Tax Office and a colleague of Lisa.
Together, we will introduce you to how we use ethics and AR at our organization. It is almost unimaginable that there ever was a time when computers didn't exist if we look at our current society. However, we managed to live without them for thousands of years. It has only been 18 years since the first general purpose computing machine was built. Around the same time, the mathematician Alan Turing first described his famous test for determining whether a machine possesses human intelligence. Since that time, we have gone from simple machines for calculations via robots and pattern recognition to a world dominated by smartphones, video cameras, and machine learning algorithms. The field is developing so rapidly that governments need to take a stand on AI. That is why 2 years ago, a European Commission AI Alliance was set up, which is a forum for open and broad discussions about all aspects of AI and its impact. The government of the Netherlands in Dutch Rijksoverheid has composed a strategic plan of action for AI for investigating the opportunities, terms and fundamentals of AI. In particular, at the Dutch Tax Office, there are already several departments making use of AI techniques to improve processes and make them less prone to errors. Later on, Raman will tell you more about these practices. However, before we start using AI, it is good to take a step back and consider the potential negative consequences. Just like any other technology, AI can be used to either help people or harm people. What sets AI apart from other technology is that we often use AI to make decisions. Therefore, when implementing AI systems, we need to take into account the ethical considerations that come with these decisions. Actually, AI only makes us aware of the ethical dilemmas present, which we would have had to deal with ourselves even without AI. A classic ethical dilemma that involves in AI is the self-driving car. When a car gets in a situation where it cannot avoid harming some people, it must be able to decide which harm is worse. Should it hit either a child or the old lady, or should it crash itself into a car? A less clear but still relevant example is the hunt for fraudsters using AI. After all, it can be extremely harmful to someone if they are wrongly marked as fraudster. Okay, so you might say, so ethics are important, but why should we software developers care about ethics? Isn't that a responsibility of the business so that we software developers can create software? No, ethics concerns everyone. In the first place, we are all human beings, so all of our actions have a moral component, whether we want it or not. Secondly, as employees, we have to work according to the ethical guidelines of our organization. And finally, as software developers, we have a professional duty to create software in a responsible way. Fortunately, we are not alone in this. The European High-Level Group on Artificial Intelligence has already identified a set of guidelines for trustworthy and reliable AI. In the next part of, this presentation, I will speak some more about three of these subjects, namely privacy, fairness, and transparency, because these are the most relevant to developers. In 2018, a new privacy law was adopted in Europe, whose Dutch name is the Algemene Verordening Gegevensbescherming, AVG. This law received a lot of attention in the media, so it is quite likely that privacy is one of the first associations you have with the theme of data, ethics, and AI. That is for good reason, because when using AI techniques without caution, AI can seriously violate our privacy. Most obviously, since AI is about processing data, it can pose a risk to our informational privacy. That is, the freedom to determine exactly who gets to see what part of the data associated with you. Of course, historically, the concept of privacy is much broader than that. There's also physical privacy, the freedom to not be seen, heard, or touched by others in a space. Moreover, there's decisional privacy, the freedom to exclude others from decisions that only belong to the individual and his or her intimate. At the Dutch Tax Office, we obviously need to protect informational privacy, but we certainly respect the other two as well. Namely, Dutch citizens do not need to explain in their annual tax return why they make a donation to one cause and not to the other. And for the field, it would be a lot easier to track down fraudsters if everyone could be followed with microphone and camera all day. Still, in our country, we choose not to allow such practices. This brings us to the question, why do we find privacy so important? Does privacy perhaps have intrinsic value to us? That is privacy a good thing in itself, like happiness, love, and freedom? Or does instead privacy have instrumental value? Is it the means to obtain another valuable end, such as protection against exploitation? Perhaps even more strongly, is privacy perhaps essential to other values? Is it not possible to have a solid definition of friendship or trust without the concept of privacy? No matter how we choose to answer these questions as a society, we need to make sure that our AI does not violate these agreements. In the first place, AI models can be so strong that they deduce information about us that was not asked for beforehand. These algorithms might deduce information about our emotional or physical state from typing or speech patterns, or even deduce information about our ethnicity or political preferences. These unwanted deductions can cause undesirable actions. A real-life example of this was one from the expenses of a 16-year-old girl at a grocery store. It was deduced that she was pregnant. Consequently, the store sent coupons relating to pregnancy to her home. However, the girl had not yet told her parents that she was expecting a child. In this case, clearly decisional privacy was violated, and depending on the family situation, this might have had bad consequences. Secondly, when combining multiple data sets, AI might be able to undo the anonymization of one or more of these data sets. Consider, for example, the location data that Google collects via smartphones. This is saved anonymized, but you may imagine that when combining this with 4G or Wi-Fi location data, it is still possible to trace individuals. Finally, it can be hard to remove outdated or faulty data from models. Suppose, for example, that somebody has once wrongly been marked as fraudster. It is then undesirable that this person gets extra verification or is even refused during application for a new insurance. At the Dutch Tax Office, the issue of fairness is just as current and important as the issue of privacy. In the Netherlands, we collectively agree that in the eyes of the law, all Dutch citizens are equal. Our basic human rights are described in the Dutch Constitution, the Grondwet. This constitution, together with all other laws, forms a framework for determining how to treat people fairly. However, the problem with general laws that apply to everyone is that not everybody is the same and lives through the same situations. As an executive organization, the Dutch Tax Office always needs to find a balance between complying with the Dutch law and acting with a human touch. Still, even after we have determined what a fair treatment of people looks like, making sure that our AI models behave fair is a whole other matter. During the collection of the data and during the implementation of the model, there are many ways in which mistakes can happen, negatively biasing a model towards a minority. In the first place, the quality of the model depends entirely on the quality of the data that is used. If the data is discriminatory towards a group of people, the model will learn to discriminate in equal measure. A famous example of this is the resume selection software of Amazon. This software selected candidates that seemed most promising for the position of software developer. However, when testing the model, it was noticed that the software selected drastically more male candidates than female candidates, even though the candidates looked equally promising on paper. It turned out that historically, there had been drastically working more male developers than female developers at Amazon. Therefore, the model concluded that male developers were more successful than female developers, even though this historic imbalance of gender had an entirely different cause. Secondly, not only the data, but also the technical implementation of a system can lead to a negative bias towards some people. If a system is harder to use for some people, then they might make more mistakes while using it and are therefore perhaps more often wrongly marked as fraudster. This might happen if people do not understand the language of the system correctly, or if a visual disability prevents them from using the full capabilities of the system, as illustrated by this picture. Finally, if the results of a self-learning model are interpreted incorrectly, then a bias might enter the model, which only increases over time. We call this a result bias or a feedback loop bias. For example, in the United States, there was a police station that wanted to make an AI model for predicting the locations in the city where criminal activities would happen. They created this model using data that included reportings from citizens. Then they patrolled more in the areas with high risk. On top of that, they updated the model continuously to make sure its predictions remained up to date. Of course, the intention was that the areas with initially high risk would become less attractive to criminals over time. However, instead, the model pointed more and more strongly towards these areas as the time went by. How could this possibly happen? It turned out that citizens not only reported crime when they saw an actual criminal activity happen, but also when they only saw a police car or officer and merely suspected crime happening nearby. Therefore, the more the police patrolled in an area, the more reportings were fed into the model, the more the model pointed toward this area, the more surveillance in this area, and so forth, creating a continuous feedback loop. So far, we have seen in what ways AI can violate our privacy and in what ways AI models can be unfair or biased. Now it is time to make sure that our own models do not violate our human rights. It is therefore necessary that we have some understanding of our model and that it is not a black box where the input is transformed into an output without us knowing or understanding what happens. Instead, our model should be transparent. Without transparency, it is hard, if not impossible, to detect bias in our model. Note that a black box model can still be useful, though. It can serve as an upper limit to what a transparent model could potentially achieve. We can then incrementally improve our transparent model until it almost reaches the quality of the black box model. We distinguish several subtypes of transparency. We call a model explainable if we can describe in human language what the model does and how it came to its decision or result. This might seem a bit contradictory to the nature of an AI model, because processing large amounts of data is a task that is very hard for human beings. So how can we possibly make sure that not only experts, but also non-experts have some understanding of what happens inside of the model? To illustrate this point, I would like to compare an AI model to a car. A car gets us to places much faster and far more comfortably than simply walking ever could. But most of us do not know the inner workings of the car. Still, we trust that if we steer right, that the car does not go left. And we trust that the car has been manufactured with everybody's safety in mind. And finally, we trust that there are indeed experts who do know what happens inside of the car. In the same way, everybody should be able to trust that the decisions of the model are sound and at least verifiable by experts. Moreover, according to the Dutch constitution, everybody has the right to get an explanation of verdicts, just as a human judge needs to be able to explain his or her verdict. A transparent model is also traceable. It needs to be clear what steps the algorithm performs to get from input to output. This includes information about who did what to both the code and the data. Otherwise, a malicious developer might tweak the model in such a way that it only outputs values in favor of the developer. Finally, a transparent model is interpretable in reality. After all, an AI model is just an abstract algorithm that converts one set of numbers into another set of numbers. Its true value lies in the translation to physical things and processes in the physical world. An example of how this can go wrong was when a bank decided to make a machine learning model to predict the success of small businesses whose owners were customers at the bank. One bank employee noticed a negative trend for one of the businesses and decided to call its owner. Yes, according to indicator 8 of our model, your company is going to have a hard time. But unfortunately, I cannot tell you what indicator 8 means. Of course, such a statement is totally useless and perhaps even harmful, because now the business owner might do things that make the situation even worse. Another field where interpretability is integral is healthcare. These days, many bodily functions of patients are monitored on the intensive care, and more AI models are used to make predictions about the recovery of patients. Doctors should then be able to translate the results to actual treatments and adapt general findings to the specific patient present. Now that we know the basics of the ethical considerations when using AI, it is time to start learning about the various AI techniques. Most of the AI we currently use is not a form of general intelligence, but instead created to solve a very specific problem, such as recognizing speech or playing chess. Many of these models use machine learning. Machine learning is a collection of AI techniques where the computer learns from data on its own. We call this the training of a model. After training, the model can make decisions or predictions about new unknown data. In abstract terms, the model finds the best fitting function f that transforms the known input x to a certain output. And after this function has been determined, it can compute output values using this function f for new unknown data input. For supervised algorithms like classification and regression, these output values need to be contained in the training dataset. For example, with classification, we first need to classify the training data ourselves, and after training, the model can classify new data. On the other hand, unsupervised algorithms can find structure and pattern in the data themselves, so these output values need not be present in the training data. These algorithms can, for example, determine what data points look similar or are close to one another and classify them in the same category. Neural networks are a technique loosely inspired by the human brain. It works by sending signals between layers of nodes. A deep learning network is a neural network with many of these layers of nodes. Now I would like to use a case to describe the steps we need to take to make a machine learning model, especially taking into account the ethical theory we just discussed. The case is as follows. Every year, Dutch citizens need to file their tax return. But there are always people who forget to do this before the deadline. We would like to make a model that predicts which Dutch citizens are likely to forget it and are helped by an additional personal reminder. However, we would like to avoid remind people who do not need one because that might cause annoyance. The first and maybe most important step is to determine clearly the problem that the model needs to solve. Without a clear problem, and without a clear goal, one cannot test whether the model works correctly, let alone whether it does so in a fair and unbiased way. In our case, we would like to know that given the Dutch citizen, if he or she needs a personal reminder. Given this description, there are several machine learning techniques which could be used, for example, a decision tree. A decision tree is a directed graph consisting of nodes and branches, where each node represents a decision and each branch below an option of this decision. With our data point, we start at the top of the tree and then go down each branch that corresponds with our data point until we reach an answer below at the bottom at the leaf of the tree. A machine learning algorithm can now compute the optimal selection of nodes and branches that solves our problem. Note that I say optimal, because of course it is easy to give a decision tree that outputs a reminder for everyone who needs it, namely a single branch down below to the answer yes, a reminder is needed. Of course, then everybody who does not need a reminder also gets a reminder, and that is undesirable. Therefore, we need to give our algorithm some additional constraints. In our case, we might require that the model should send an unjustified reminder to at most 5% of the people. The next step is collecting and cleaning the data. A famous expression in this context is garbage in, garbage out. If the quality of the data is low, then the quality of the model will be low as well. Moreover, we need to think about what data is ethical to use in this context. For example, we might not want to use gender and nationality. Note, however, that it is not sufficient to just throw these gender and nationality out of the data set, because other parts of the data might be invisible indicators. For example, often groups of foreigners live in the same neighborhood, so address might be an invisible indicator for nationality. Furthermore, we identify the features of the data that are relevant to the problem. A feature is a property of the data. For example, if the data contains addresses, then a possible feature is zip code or city. Such a larger type of location may be more useful than specific addresses. After we have finished preparing the data, we can actually train the model. We use 80% of the data to train the model and 20% of the data to validate the model afterwards. Namely, we need to check that the model does not fit the training data too precisely, because otherwise we might find all sorts of connections that do not actually exist, as illustrated by this rightmost image. Finally, we interpret the results of the model and connect everything back to reality. We should always ask ourselves if the results make sense and if they are not the product of coincidences or mistakes. To summarize, when making a machine learning model, we first determine the goal and optimization problem. Then we prepare the data. Next, we train and validate the model. And finally, we interpret results. Now I would like to give the floor to Ramon so that he can show us how often the theory just discussed is already in use at the Dutch tax office.
Yes, thanks Lisa for the information about AI and ethics and introduction to the basics of machine learning. As mentioned, as design authority of the Center of Excellence Group at the Dutch tax office, these topics of AI, or better of course machine learning, are part of my daily work. In our group, we focus on integrating machine learning models with a focus on natural language processing, or NLP, into existing operational processes. So in this last part of the presentation, I would like to briefly introduce you to our AI lifecycle framework and give a global overview of our model development production line and show you some internal examples of how we use these techniques in several use cases. So to start with, let me guess if this works. Yes. To start with a framework model of AA lifecycle management framework. Our AI lifecycle framework is based on three common used frameworks or workflows. So AI model lifecycle management, the data science method known as CRISP MOQ, and the continuous delivery framework or process out of the software development domain. Well, here you see an overview of how we integrated these three methods. Frameworks. The framework we created consists of three steps: the project initiation step, seen in yellow; the project experimentation step or lab phase, shown a little bit in orange; and finally the productionized step, which is light blue on the right side. Now, as an example, during the project initiation step, we validate that the process, that the business questions complies to our standards we use in our center of excellence. For instance, we validate if a so-called WMK check, WMK, toets in Dutch, has been done or is available. Well, what is this check about? It's about, do we want to do the project? Are we allowed to do the project? And are we able to do the project? And next to that, sometimes a privacy impact assessment is part of this check if personal information is involved in the question we get from the business. Finally, we also check if there is a legal basis for the project, and if the project doesn't comply to all our standards, we just don't accept it as something we want to work on. During the analysis and data science step, of course, data science plays a huge role. It's in the orange part of this on the sheet. In this step, it is, for instance, important that data is minimized, or data access is minimized, experiments are reproducible, and access to data, model, or code is locked. Just like Lisa mentioned, we sure want to have a traceability on who did what on our models to be able to be transparent about the end results in the end. Next to these subjects, it's also important to understand or explore the possible biases in your data, and of course, which features are selected for the model or are explicitly left out. The same as Lisa just mentioned in the steps to take in machine learning, developing a machine learning model. As within the software development process, the four eyes principle plays a big role during this step. So often not only one developer or data scientist creates an option, but it's verified by at least somebody else. If an acceptable model has been engineered, where a major role is also reserved for the business for the acceptable part in that that sentence, the last step of productionize is carried out. It uses a software development process for deploying a machine learning model to be used as a service by other processes. A point of attention in this step is to monitor your model performance during the lifetime of the service. Due to the nature of the use techniques, performance might drop or a model drift may occur. And therefore, you will have to keep in touch with the business for detecting these issues and together take an appropriate decision for the best action. So it's a lot of the framework, and this is an overview of it. And in our framework, we have automated a lot of the matters I just discussed by being able to produce relevant artifacts like log files or who accessed what, or being able to reproduce a model outcome or performance and use this as proof during, for instance, an internal or external audit that we're getting. So just to give you a basic overview of how our lifecycle management framework applies. And let's see if I can get the next sheet. Yes, and of course, so how's our method for building machine learning applications? So the major thing I want to point to is that we handle data, model, and code separately, which is shown in this sheet. So, I will get a little bit later in the next sheet on this topic. What you see here is that experiments are one of the important role of the development. We need to make models, like I just mentioned, and we need to make the models also transparent and reproducible. Why is important to separate these three lines? Well, I can just show you on the next slide. our method for building machine learning applications. So yet again, a little bit simplified, but here you say we have an experiment phase, and in an experiment phase, we use scripts, notebooks, small Java applications, often Python in this case. We prototype for the code, it's separately versioned and monitored. Same goes for the model. So we have prototype models in the beginning of our process. And later on, you see in the production lives that we get a versionized model that we can separately track from the code and from the data. And the same goes for data. Here you see that there are often local data sets only available to the team who is developing a model, while in production you have a version data set needed in central storage with a lot more security and privacy issues that we have implemented around being able to use that kind of data. So just to give you a little bit of an introduction about how we build our machine learning applications. Yet another one, I think this is also a nice picture from development, the repository, building and production. The bottom low, it starts with experimenting. Then we use our development tools to create on the bottom left to develop the application. We store all our code in Bitbucket and have automation via Jenkins. And then we have, if we are going to build, we have a data pipeline. So data is separately handled during our during the process. Data gets retrieved from IBM file stores or databases. We store it locally, so we can train our machine learning pipeline in the build the ML pipeline box. And if we have built a model, then we use experiment tracking for machine learning using MLflow, and we store our model in Nexus. And of course, being able to build applications, we use OpenShift to be able to create containers and make it easy to deploy a certain model as a service within our application landscape. Yet it's only half an hour presentation, so we can fill a whole day about this, but let me take you to some of the use cases. Well, this one is in Dutch, so for the English the translation will come. Siri is the computer system which the government relates all kinds of data of citizens to each other in order to search for fraud. And it's an example of why we need to take care on being able to explain what data is used, where it is used for, and create transparency why someone is targeted by an algorithm. Based on the judgments of a judge, the government had to stop using the computer system based on several rulings that the judge saw. So just to point out a little bit about this text, the system was okay, but the problem was it was too great invasion of privacy. It was not controllable. There's no personal data that cannot be processed. So not clear what makes someone a potential fraudster, or people who have done nothing are scrutinized. So there is a lot of this system we can learn from within the tax office about how to be transparent in our way of working. So from the beginning to the end, being in control of applications using machine learning techniques is a good lesson we can learn from, sometimes when it goes wrong. So a little bit closer for the next case. One of the good examples of how we apply machine learning within the tax office at the moment is the case of metadating the objections of on the income tax. A couple of hundred thousands of objections are sent to the tax office each year, and it would be nice to automate a lot of manual labor that's being involved in this process by reading the objections, retrieving information out of it before sending it based on the information to the right colleague who should handle the case. Well, here you see a process, the whole process, and if you zoom a little bit in where we put in our solution, it's on the bottom left, it's just being marked. So what are objections? This is an example letter we get at the tax office. It's a nice one, and we get all kinds of features out of it. So what kind of document is it? Who submitted it? What is objected to? Who can handle this objection? What's the objection amount, etc.? And we use different algorithms to extract features from the letters. Some are regular expressions. Some are machine learning algorithms. The one question we don't do is the objection justified? Because that's one of the things, according to Dutch law, a human should have the last result in that. So we do a lot of work metadating all kinds of information from letters. Another one is digitization of the notarial deeds is another example of how we use machine learning techniques in our primary process. In this case, we have automated the information extraction of around 1.5 million deeds that the tax office receives every year. And EAI, we use enterprise application integration to combine the information we take from the deeds together with already known information in the tax office. So here you see certain things we get out of that: persons, role, the roles, dates, references of law. And to give a little presentation, the deed gets in, gets stored. We get a signal in our system. We use IBM Content Analytics for this. And we retrieve all this information and make sure it's get processed in the next part or BPM processes which follow. So one of the, finally here, the last case is that of the conversational AI, which is a hot topic within the tax office. Some bad examples you can see on the sheet here, where a public bot of Microsoft was set out into the world based on active learning on the community, but it didn't went well, the newborn bot was gone from humans are great to all humans should die in less than 24 hours. And even last year, the same happened with a South Korean chatbot, and even personal information could be accessed in a conversation due to the fact that they were using private information during training. So chatbots are hot topics within the tax office. We can learn from these examples that we should like to prevent, what we should like to prevent for ourselves. So what should we not do to be able to use these kinds of techniques? We could do that, for instance, by applying our AI lifecycle management framework and ethical framework during development of these kinds of solutions. For now, our time is ending, and I would like to thank you all for watching our presentation. And we would like to see you in our Q&A session following this presentation. Thanks for your attention.
Je kan je hart weer ophalen binnen deze organisatie als IT'er, omdat je hier met de laatste technologieën werkt. En met die laatste technologieën kunnen wij ook volledig de digitalisering van de rechtspraak ondersteunen. Ik ben Lars en ik ben manager van infrastructuur en datacenter management.
Ik ben Marcel en ik ben directeur IT bij Ivo Rechtspraak.
Inhoudelijk is het denk ik heel leuk om hier te werken, omdat wij hier eigenlijk alles doen. Dus we zijn met infrastructuur bezig, we ontwikkelen applicaties, we beheren applicaties, we zijn volop bezig met security. En omdat het een redelijk overzichtelijke en middelgrote organisatie is, zijn de mogelijkheden ook legio.
Ik ben Sabine en ik ben business analyst bij Ivo Rechtspraak. Ik denk als business analyst ben je echt de vertaler tussen de business en IT, noemen we dat altijd. En zorg dat je van beide begrijpt wat ze willen, wat ze bedoelen. Zodat je eigenlijk een systeem uitkomt wat de rechtspraak wil en kan gebruiken. Maar ook wat de IT'ers binnen Ivo kunnen bouwen.
Mijn naam is Lara en ik werk als front-end developer bij Ivo Rechtspraak. Als front-end developer heb je te maken met alles wat inhoudt over de user interface. En we zijn de missing link tussen de UX designers en de back-end developers. Elke dag is een nieuwe puzzel om op te lossen, eigenlijk. En verschillende situaties, verschillende applicaties, verschillende technologieën. Het is elke dag iets nieuws.
Dus je zit eigenlijk heel dicht, zit je op de gebruikers. En daarmee eigenlijk op maatschappelijke relevantie, alles waar wij mee bezig zijn, zie je vrij snel zeg maar in het nieuws langskomen. Daar zitten wij eigenlijk vrij dicht achter om dat mogelijk te maken. De organisatie heeft zowel de klantvertegenwoordiging als IT in huis en dat werkt gewoon heel goed.